Tim Sexton is no stranger to Wildland Fire. This former AFMO, FMO, F-band, and Hotshot Superintendent has also logged long stints as both a Type 1 and Type 2 IC. As you listen to Tim's story, you'll see how he has carried his grounded GS-3 and GS-5 Wildland Firefighter insights and lessons all the way up to his many Washington office-level fire positions. In 1975, at the beginning of his extensive interagency wildland fire career, Tim moves up from his seasonal wildland firefighter fuels position on the Shasta Trinity National Forest to become the GS-5 crew foreman for the 20-person regional reinforcement fire crew on the Pacific Northwest's Gifford Pinchot National Forest.
Well, when I was on the Shasta Trinity National Forest on a fuels crew, we did a lot of hand piling, and every fall we would burn piles, but that was the extent of the prescribed burning that I was exposed to in California. The first week on the job on the Gifford Pinchot, we burned a 150-acre clear cut that had probably 100 to 150 tons per acre. I'd never seen fire behavior like that, even on the most intense wildfire. We started that burn at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The ignition was completed by 6, and the fire management officer told me, okay, you're gonna stay here with 10 people and hold this all night, and the rest of us are done. I hadn't even walked around the whole unit yet, so as I walked around the unit after everybody left, I found about 15 acres outside of the unit, and based on my experiences in California, that would have been two or three 20-person crews to manage that. So I immediately called back and asked for that, and they said, we'll send you one engine. So we rode that out the rest of the night, and then I finally understood that a little slop over on those clear cut units was not a necessarily out of the planned way of doing business. Over the course of that summer, we burned 50 or 60 clear cut units, most of them very large. They were conducted before the Monongahela Act that limited the size of our clear cuts. Very impressive fire behavior. I learned more about fire behavior that summer on our prescribed burns than I had in the previous 5 or 6 years of working on wildfires. In between prescribed burning, the regional reinforcement crew that I supervised, we were assigned to 11 fires in about 10 different western states. We went to Southern California and filled in behind the Chileo hotshots for a week, did an initial attack on the Angeles. We were on a fire on the Medicine Bow in Wyoming where the hoses froze in the late season fire, and a lot of country in between. So it was a very stimulating summer, learned a lot about fire behavior, learned about a lot about crew management, and it really was the summer that launched me on my career. I made a lot of mistakes that year, and I did have one individual who was a great mentor, Frank Turner. He was the fuel specialist, and I consulted with him quite a bit when I ran into trouble, and he helped me quite a bit in working through difficult situations, supervisory situations. I had to fire a couple of folks, didn't know whether I could or not. Didn't know how to go about doing that. Again, Frank was very instrumental in helping me successfully negotiate through that. As far as my personal development, I developed more confidence in myself, but also a little more humility in what is actually required to keep 20 people safe. There were a number of close calls that it's amazing that the Forest Service allowed somebody as young as I was and with as little experience as I had to have the safety and of 19 other folks under my charge. But those were different times, and we had the agency as itself, particularly in fire, was evolving. Tremendous diversity of experiences, both in different fuel types and wildfire situations, as well as the really immersion into prescribed fire and fire behavior associated with that during that season. There was a couple of things that really hung with me from that one season. One of which was the at least the beginnings of leadership. Prior to that, I'd been a BD crew foreman for a year, and it was four people, and it was more of a team than it was me leading them, per se. But with 20 people, I was compelled to be a leader, and again, made a lot of mistakes, but was able to look at those mistakes, for the most part, as learning experiences. And so the ability to manage a crew and provide leadership, that was one of the experiences that I guess helped provide some foundation to those skills and abilities that I developed further later. The other aspect of that in personal development was the development of the ability to assess fire behavior and understand the risks and trade-offs of fire burning at various levels and what one could do personally in engaging that fire directly or needing to be indirect. We had slash burn units where logs 3 and 4 inches in diameter were lofted from the convection columns and sucked in. Again, never had seen anything like that, and rarely see it even to this day. But the diversity of fire behavior and the knowledge of the weather conditions that contribute to that fire behavior, that was really the foundation of my beginning development of an appreciation for that and understanding of fire behavior. The fire operations section at BFC had about 40 folks, and we could configure as two hotshot crews or as individual miscellaneous overhead. And given a lot of training to be able to accept some of those miscellaneous overhead assignments, and over the course of a couple of years there, received a number of different assignments in planning section, in logistics, and in operations. And again, really broadened my appreciation for fire management in general, where prior I had viewed fire management strictly in the operational sense of line diggers and crew bosses, and at the time sector bosses and division bosses and so on. My experience at BFC broaden that to include all of the other functional areas in managing a fire with an incident management team. And again, developed some skills there, and also saw a lot of new country from the standpoint of how fire burns across the U.S. Assignments from Alaska to the rangelands and the Intermountain area to the adjacency of deserts in the Southwest, and continue to develop my understanding of fire behavior in various fuel types and regions of the country. One of the experiences I had that stuck in my mind most, I guess, associated with fire behavior is I gained an appreciation for live fuel moisture. We were on a fire outside of Pinedale, Wyoming, burning in ponderosa pine, and as the fire swept out of the ponderosa pine and into the sagebrush, this was a fire in June, it hit the sagebrush and died, and I just couldn't believe what I was seeing, and finally figured out that it was the live fuel moisture of the sagebrush was so high that it wouldn't support fire. And so I started putting together some of those elements of fire behavior that I hadn't learned even in the slash burning experience that I had previously. As an assistant fire management officer, I was again thrust not only into the supervision role, but also I had to learn that I was management now and not just one of the guys or gals. So that was a transition. Again, a few bumps, but I had a good fire management officer that I worked for, Dave Baldwin, who helped me quite a bit in that transition.
What were some of those bumps?
Some of the bumps included at that time, we were bringing women into the organization in a fairly big way, and just shifting the way I had managed the regional reinforcement crew, which was all male, to managing a more diverse workforce. You know, at the time, previously, the language we used was certainly not appropriate with the 20-person crew, and sometimes it's very difficult to change many of those habits you get into, and so that was one of the things that was really necessary to adjust to once I became a not only a supervisor but a manager of a more diverse workforce. Part of the issue that was difficult was when there was a wildfire, I wasn't necessarily able to go to that wildfire each time. I just needed to make sure that the wildfire had a response, an initial attack, and that it was done safely. And so it was often very frustrating sitting in the office listening to it over the radio and not being there. So a lot of patience was developed, and then the need to trust the folks that work for you was also something that I had to work on. Well, a lot of it was good communication and discussion on what's required on a wildfire and some personal observation. I don't think I could have developed the trust without the personal observation, but then their willingness to trust me had to do with my willingness to allow them to do their job. My supervisor, he led by example in allowing me some flexibility and latitude to do my job, and not over-managing. So I learned by watching his way of supervising me and tried to emulate that. When I took the job as superintendent of the Redmond Hotshot crew, I had the good fortune of having an excellent assistant, Dave Craycroft, who had previously been the Hotshot foreman on his own before it was the detailer crew. And so his skills were invaluable in helping me take on the crew, 18 new people, and rapidly form them into a cohesive unit. There were a lot of challenges with that crew the first year in developing a training curricula, obtaining a variety of assignments, work assignments on the job training, and then being able to have them ready and available and skilled to serve as a hotshot crew on wildfires. And again, I don't think I could have done it by myself. It was great having a person like Dave to divide the workload and help get that thing done. There was always a challenge, though, in bringing 18 new people together who had permanent jobs, who were supervisors in their own right, and forming them into a cohesive unit that could work effectively on wildfires. And we used a lot of techniques, humor, off-job activities such as baseball games and those kind of things to work on crew cohesion. Some of those crews over the course of those 6 years I was with the Redmond Hotshots came together very quickly. Some of them it was a struggle all season. Again, there was a lot of learning that took place, not just by the crew members, but by myself and Dave, my assistant, in how to deal with a variety of personalities and backgrounds that came to that crew. One of the biggest things is communication and being very clear in your communication, because it's very easy for your intent as a leader to kind of change as it goes from you to your assistant to their assistant, and ultimately down to the person wielding a Pulaski or a nozzle on a hose. And so it's important to, again, be very clear, but also to spot check that by talking to folks at all the levels occasionally. And you got to be careful with that, so that you're not bypassing your lower level supervisors, but at least engaging the folks at the very lowest level occasionally to get an understanding of how they have grasped some of the concepts that you've communicated down. And again, that's one of the things I did frequently, both on the job and occasionally with off the job activities, barbecues or whatever, with folks that worked for me. I had four different rangers in the 11 years I was a district fire management officer, and each one had a different style. The first one I had, I was still developing my style, and we had some difficulties in communication. But the resolution of that was simply to, to address those, kind of confront those and work them out. And it was not always a very easy thing to do. The next couple of rangers, though, were a lot easier to deal with, and I had developed a few more skills in communicating. And so if there was a particularly sensitive issue, we'd usually take a drive out in the woods and to look at something, and oh, by the way, we need to discuss this. So I had a captive audience, and usually over the course of the half hour, hour drive, we could work through those things. And just the drive in the woods seemed like a good way of getting one-on-one time and be able to talk through the issue. When I took the job in Denver, I'd never been to Denver before, and never worked for the Park Service before. I only knew one individual in the office, and so everything was new. And again, two organizational levels up from where I had previously been working for the last 10 years. And there were a lot of changes in not having a piece of land that I was participating in the management of directly, and neither that nor having individuals that I provided direct supervision and management over. And so to get folks to do what we wanted them to do, even though I was staffed now and had no direct authority, was a challenge. One of the ways we approached that out of the regional office in Denver was a lot of field visits, because it's very easy to send memos out on email or call somebody up and say, this is what we need to do now. But if you have a personal visit, it's a lot more effective in ensuring that the communication is clear and that the directive actually has some chance of getting done. And my boss at the time, Dan O'Brien, the regional fire management officer for the Intermountain region, was very interested in us making personal contact. So I did a lot of traveling that year I was working out of that office, and visited probably 40 parks during that 1 year, both to see what they were doing on the ground and to provide clear leader's intent in a direct fashion rather than indirect via email or on the phone. In 1988, while I was the district fire management officer at Chiloquin, I served at Yellowstone, the big Yellowstone fires, and I went there as a fire behavior analyst. I think I filled in on Ponson's team for a short period of time, and then they left me as a Type 3 IC at Grant Village. And over the course of the next 3 or 4 weeks, my organization developed from a Type 3 organization to operations section chiefs, divisions, and the logistics section, basically a full-blown team with over 1,000 people. And the Park Service was using me rather than having another team come in to have a little more direct control over management of that particular fire. I didn't realize that until later, but in any case, they also saw this as an opportunity to get a lot of their folks some experience on this fire. And so a great number of the folks I dealt with later in the Intermountain region as the deputy fire management officer were actually assigned to me there at Grant Village in Yellowstone in 1988. There were probably six of the fire management officers that I dealt with in that region in that job I was in Denver at that worked there in 1988 with me. So Chuck Scott from Saguaro, Tim Stubbs from Carlsbad Cavern, and a number of others worked with me in Yellowstone, and I had maintained some relations with them. So that gave me a big step up in my ability to have a little bit of credibility at that field level with those particular folks. And in fact, I wasn't much of an advocate of it until I was thrust into it as the Deputy Regional Fire Management Officer. There at Chiloquin, we didn't have any opportunities. Our land management plan didn't allow it. And my attitude at the time was that it wouldn't work there. I've since changed that, but because I have much more knowledge and experience with it. But that was a big learning experience in my first year there with the Park Service in Denver. I was assigned as a Type 2 Incident Commander for the Rocky Mountain region that first year, and between the time I got there in February and later that summer, I had fully transitioned and actually accepted an assignment with my Type 2 team, a short team assignment to the Powell Ranger District as a fire use management team. So I took my Type 2 team, reconfigured it to five people, and accepted an assignment on a wildland fire use fire in the Powell Ranger District, which was kind of interesting, going from that full suppression mode I'd been in at Chiloquin to only a year later there helping to manage a fire for resource benefit. One of the other things that had been going on in my career was my participation in the S590 course, the Fire Behavior Analyst course. I became a Fire Behavior Analyst in 1984 and then joined the faculty in 1987 and had worked on the course all of that time and even now. And one of the individuals that was also in the course faculty was Jerry Williams, who is one of the other folks I consider as one of my mentors and a person that's influenced my career. And so during the course, it's a very intense course where you're doing a lot of teaching and so on, but every evening the faculty would get together and have a beer or two. We had a lot of philosophical discussions, and I think Jerry probably had been kind of opening my mind without me knowing it over a period of time, just during some of those discussions. An effective fire manager needs to have a good upbringing, both in response to wildfire, where we take aggressive action to quickly contain and minimize the growth of fire, as well as the ability to evaluate the opportunities and benefits, as well as risk afforded by a wildfire, and manage it for a long term to achieve benefits, but and even that the prescribed fire end of things. So the well-balanced fire manager of today, I believe, needs to have experience and understanding in those areas from the planned ignition through the various ways we respond to fire today. The suppression skills and ability of keeping people safe in an ever-changing wildfire dynamic, that you need to protect values, that suppression ethic is still a very needed skill and way of approaching a fire. At the same time, we need to evolve a little bit more in our appreciation that fire can help us over the long term and take advantage of those benefits afforded by it. So yeah, a good balance of all of those areas, I think, is needed to be an effective fire manager today, at least in most parts of the country. My position as a fire use program manager involves both prescribed fire and the response to wildfires where we establish resource benefit objectives. And I develop policy on both ends of those, and I provide management oversight on both ends of those that spectrum. It's important to recognize the risks and benefits associated with both the program associated with responding to wildfires, as well as that program that actively plans and then implements a management ignited fire. The challenges associated with a lot of that is encouraging folks to get more fire on the landscape in an appropriate manner as soon as we can, without taking undue risk. The scenario we're in now is the Forest Service manages close to 200 million acres, and we experience in the last decade about 1.7 million acres a year of wildfire. And at the same time, we're experiencing about the same number of acres from prescribed fire, and then another 500,000 acres from management activities, thinnings and so forth. So all told, we're getting about just short of 4 million acres a year on our landscapes treated. About half of that's in the southern region that has 13 million acres. So for the rest of the 180 some odd million acres, we're only getting a couple of million acres a year treated, less than 1% of our landscapes. Every year, fuels continue to accumulate beyond where they were before across our landscapes, when you consider that fuel accumulation minus the disturbances from prescribed fire and wildfire. At the same time, we're experiencing global climate change that is affecting our fire season severity. The length of the fire season is extending, and the severity, episodic severity of our fire seasons are increasing. There's some thought that 95th percentile weather of the 2000 decade is going to be 75th percentile weather by 2020. The way I'm looking at the prescribed fire and wildfire picture is we need to get more fire on the landscape at appropriate levels of severity sooner rather than later. So my challenge is encouraging line officers and fire managers to do more of this, but at the same time adhere to good risk management principles so that we don't have those unintended outcomes that can set the program back. I can't tell anybody to do anything. All I can do is encourage and advocate and then shape policy to a certain extent to provide as much, afford as much flexibility as possible at that local level. And so those are the approaches that I and some of my colleagues are taking to empower local folks and encourage them to get more fire on the landscape. I'm not out all season long like I used to be when I was a hot shot, but even if I can get out two or three times a year on an actual assignment, it helps ground me in what the realities are that folks in the field are facing, those challenges that may not seem like challenges when you're sitting at the Washington office, but when you're down at the ground, those challenges are real and difficult to overcome. And so it is important that that we get out, work with them, face those same challenges with them, and understand the difficulties there are in overcoming them. I think the young folks that are coming up in the organization need to approach the fire business with the idea that you're never going to know it all. Every day is a learning day, and if you keep your mind open and accept good advice from all levels, you can increase your skills very effectively. You're not gonna, if you just learn from educators or just learn from folks that are higher up than you, you're probably gonna miss some good opportunities in really getting some good clues on how to be more effective from your colleagues and even folks that work for you.